Beam for Real-Time Manufacturing Data Analysis. This is the title of the talk that I have come up with after putting in absolutely zero efforts, but at least it's self-explanatory. Anyways, my name is Jaswant Yadagani. I'm a recent graduate from Columbia University. After I joined, as soon as I graduated, I joined Odin Technologies as ML engineer. Today I'm speaking from New York. This is my first talk in an open source gathering, and I'm really excited about it today. The outline of this talk, I'll start by telling what Odin is and who our customers are, and I'll definitely end with a classic thank you slide. But whatever's in between is the journey of how data points from many sensors sitting somewhere in factory floor in rural America, which you can say it's very gibberish on the top, how it makes way into our platform, and how is it converted into an actionable statement on using which our customers can potentially save up some dollars. A bit about Odin. We're a young 6-year-old startup in industrial automation domain. We provide analytics to manufacturers that could essentially improve their processes, reduce waste, or optimize their performance. So who are our customers? They are medium to large scale industries who produce wires that run all across your walls in your homes. We have some pipe manufacturers. We have chemical resin industries, paper and pulp industries. For that matter, any industry with continuous manufacturing process are compatible with our platform and can be our potential customer. A glance into our product. We do a lot of real-time stuff. We have metrics streaming at a second resolution. We have indications of status of the factory in real time, and we send alerts when process goes into bad conditions through emails or push notifications. We have some historic analysis tools. People can go back and do root cause analysis of their problems. And we have many dashboards which indicate key performance indexes and which allow customers to compare the previous runs and today's runs and sort of do all those things. Now to do this, we first have to ingest data of customers into our platform. So let's look at how our ingestion pipeline looks like. So if you think of a factory, there are like a ton of sensors sitting around which pop data every second, some every 5 seconds, but trust me, everything is in asynchronous manner. And there are operators running around from line to line, set the recipe parameters, get the process to stabilization, and ensure production is being done. Now, as they do their work, they do log certain events into our platform. Now, all these real-time measures are communicated to us via OPCVA servers. OPCVA is a data exchange standard for industrial IoT communications. Basically, machine-to-machine or PC-to-machine comms happen through this protocol. We are completely on Google Cloud, so we use their product Cloud IoT Core. It basically reads, it acts as an entry point from factory into the cloud. So it publishes messages into PubSub, and a lot of streaming calculations happen in this block using Dataflow Runner. And once the data is extracted and transformed into our Odin data model, we store them in time series database for retroactive access. And on the other hand, we have data maps, metadata, and process targets. Basically, these are one-off information which are configured by customers when they onboard, and pretty much they stay as it is, or they change very rarely. So we get that information through API and store it in Cloud SQL and Postgres. So now that we have customers' data fed into our system, customers do come up with very interesting questions. Let's look at a few of customer requirements or questions of interest that they'd have. So they'd like to know what's the total production that they have today, or can I run at a higher rate, or can I pull an yellow flag and say that this is a maintenance window, or how to reduce waste or bleed that occurs during cold start period of a run, or is the product quality good, or are we running factory at a max possible efficiency? I know these are a lot of questions, and it is practically impossible for us to know all the questions beforehand. There could also be different questions that depend on underlying processes, like depending on the factory structure or the organization chart or anything. So instead of knowing all the questions, we decided to build tools into our platform so that customers can go and find their answers in a seamless fashion. And the core to all these tools is the streaming metric calculations that we do using Apache Beam. We have three jobs that act as foundation. they are stateless calculations, windowed calculations, and stateful calculations. Again, I've put zero efforts in naming these, but let me tell you what happens inside the streaming calculation jobs. As I said, the Cloud IoT Core is our entry point into GCP. It publishes messages into raw events topic. And there is a job called acquisition. It's a beam job, which applies few basic transformations, and it acts as a router for all the downstream topics. There are many crazy things that happen downstream, but in this talk, I'm going to discuss only about one topic called metrics. Essentially, all the sensor readings that come out of factory make their way into this topic. And this is where we start applying streaming calculations on. First, let's look at stateless calculations. These are operations on data that is available at the present moment. Let me walk you through a user requirement that we address using these stateless calculations. In one of our cable manufacturing customers, there are two lasers at the end of the manufacturing process that measure what's the X diameter of the cable and what's the Y diameter of the cable. And user would like to know what's the diameter of the cable that is being produced. So what we do, we apply a stateless transformation on these two raw streams and extract mean of these two raw streams in real time and generate a new stream called diameter. If you look into this, the customer only cares about what's the value of blue line is, and green and black lines, which are X and Y diameters, are of no interest to them. Now, once we extract this diameter stream, we write it back into metrics topic. This loop is very important because now this diameter stream is available for downstream calculations that can make use of this new stream. Next, we got windowed metrics. These are operations on data that is gathered in a window of predefined size. Let's see how this windowed metrics can be used. For every product that is being manufactured, there is an upper specification limit and a lower specification limit. And customer would like to know if the product that is being produced is under this specification limit or not. If they exceed upper specification limit, they are essentially wasting the amount of material that they used to produce. And if they violate the lower specification limit, they are coating less insulation on the cable, and thereby they compromise safety. So it's very important for the user to monitor these values in real time as the material is being produced. So what we do, we apply a windowed transformation on the diameter stream and extract average diameter and standard deviation of that diameter in a window of size 60 seconds with 5 second slide. And we check for limit violations using the average stream, and we look for Six Sigma stability violations using both average and standard deviation measures. And the violation Boolean stream at the end, this stream tells us if the diameter is off specs in real time. So now that we have the violation Boolean stream, we write it back again into the metrics topic for the exact same purpose of downstream calculations. And lastly, we have stateful calculations. These are the operations that leverage advantages of maintaining memory and are custom reset upon events that happen on the factory floor. Say like when a new batch is being produced or a shift change has happened or something like that. Let's see how this is useful. Now that customer is able to monitor if there is a violation or not on the diameter, he'd like to know after a batch is done, how much of the cable is off specs so that he can go back and either rework on that cable or label it as bad product and sort of dispose it, or he can ship it up into the production. So what we do, we apply a stateful calculation on top of the violation Boolean stream, and we reset that on every new batch, and we apply a time aggregate function on top of that. This tells us how much time is the diameter is in violation in that stream. And by just taking product of line speed with the duration, it'll tell us how much cable is bad in the batch that is just produced. So these three beam jobs with the recursive loop architecture that we have will allow us to create arbitrary combinations and realize complete algebra on the streaming metric calculations. So this is how we configure these calculations in our platform. So we select a source metric, and we select the window size, slide, And we do have some templates of functions which we think would be useful for customers. But another interesting feature that we have is the ability to write custom function that that is of interest to the customer. For that purpose, we have embedded Rhino JavaScript interpreter within the Beam Pardus. So now that we have went through the streaming calculations architecture, let's see how we use it to alert on bad process conditions. A quick run through into cable manufacturing process. So extruder pulls all the copper from in spool into it, and plastic is melted from the top and is coated on over that copper. And afterwards, it's cooled in a vacuum chamber. And then at the end, a quality measurement is done and it's pulled into an out spool. So there are three dependent variables that are melt temperature, line speed, and vacuum pressure. There are three independent variables, and there is one dependent variable, outer diameter. So we have some decision trees trained on this data using the historic samples that we have. And decision trees give us some rules like of this sort, which tells of all the observations that it has seen in previously, all 100% led to bad production quality when these specific process parameters are met. So we set these, we realized this calculation using the three streaming calculations that we have. So first we set a windowed calculation on melt temperature using the mean function, and next vacuum pressure with minimum function. And lastly, we set stateful calculation on line speed with time aggregate function. So by combining these three streams, we are able to extract a target stream, which tells us whenever the process enters into bad production conditions. So by just monitoring this target stream, we are able to alert manufacturers or alert people on the factory floor saying that there is some violation of outer diameter on line two, and they can go back into the factory floor and check if the process parameters are correct or if there is any problem on the line. So that essentially concludes our journey of how raw data from a factory floor makes its way into a meaningful statement. But just before I close, I have some comments on Beam. So what we love, we have engineers with very high opinions on what language to use. So having multi-language compatibility in Beam is very useful feature for us. And we are completely on GCP, and Dataflow Runner seamlessly supports Beam jobs. So so Beam has become our go-to choice. We leverage ton of Beam's features. So watermarks, windows, triggers, state APIs. So this is a good thing for us. But we do face some work. We do face some limitations on Beam, and we had to work around for some crazy stuff. So when data from a factory comes late, it stalls all our windowing watermarks. So due to lack of per key based watermark, we had to leverage Beam state API to define our own custom watermark function. And the recursive loops that I said before do clog when data comes late into the platform, say in the order of days or sometimes even weeks. So how to overcome these are addressed by one of my colleague, Devin Petikulas, in another talk tomorrow. So if you enjoyed this talk, I'm sure you'll enjoy his even more. So that's the end of this presentation. And as I said, I'll ending with a thank you slide. And we are hiring. Visit odin.io/careers for more information. Thank you.